For the last, gosh, it's getting to be, well, you can say exactly 10 Sundays. Of course, we had a couple of breaks in there. So it's been a bit. We've been talking about and working through the 12 steps of AA, but from a New Testament point of view, bringing a spiritual connection that was always there, but we're trying to make it more overt. So we're really looking at expanding the notion of the 12 steps, especially since we learned early on that everybody is recovering from something. None of us are exempt. And so the steps are not just for those that are suffering from substance abuse, but all of us. In fact, recovery, we can understand, is transformation, spiritual transformation, or what the Bible calls salvation. Because salvation to the Jews is spiritual liberation right here and right now. It doesn't have anything to do with eventually going to heaven and avoiding hell. It's what's happening right here and right now. So the 11th step, let's go ahead and read it. I think Alex will probably get it up there. But sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God, praying only for knowledge of God's will for us and the power to carry that out. Pretty straightforward, it seems, but there's so much here. Now, I had a client a long time ago in recovery, and she said, you don't really do the 12 step. You don't really do the 11th step, do you? And what she was really talking about as the conversation unfolded is that prayer is something that we do always. It's not really a step that we're just going to do once, like an event. It's going to be a process. And really beyond that, if we really take prayer to where it needs to be, it's an attitude toward life. It's an inclination toward life. It's a perspective that we have about life that keeps us in a prayerful state. I love the Aramaic word for prayer, which is selah. And selah is actually a hunting term. We've talked about this before. It has to do with the attitude and the posture that a hunter has after laying a snare for the animal and covering it over and retreating into the blind. It's a leaning into. It's an inclination toward. It's an expectance of something coming. It's every nerve on a hair trigger. It's that kind of hyper-awareness and yet also silence, solitude, right? It's the perfect attitude to describe the way the Hebrews saw prayer. And we have lost that, but we need to get back to that understanding of prayer as a living attitude that we carry with us all the days and moments of our lives. Not something we do, but something we become, something we actually are. But before we can live prayer like this, you know, before we can have an attitude of prayer like this, we're going to have to prepare the soil a bit. This just doesn't come naturally. In fact, it's exact opposite. It is so against our nature, especially now in modern Western culture. It's against our nature. So we're going to have to prepare the soil. For 3 decades, I think it was about 36 years, I worked for a nonprofit humanitarian organization that worked primarily in Mexico and along the border corridor and down Baja. And we worked for 2 things. We worked for children to keep them fed and keep them in school. We figured nutrition and education. If you can get those 2 things going through a child's formative years, they've got a chance to break the cycle of poverty. And so we understood that our mission was to fill the bellies of the children, but we only fed them breakfast, and that seemed a little counterintuitive to some people. But breakfast was the important meal, because if we could feed them in the morning, then they could actually focus on their studies during the school day. How are you supposed to do that when your stomach's growling? How are you supposed to do that? In fact, if you want to teach anybody anything who is starving, what do you have to do? You got to feed them first. Simple. If you want to preach to anybody who's starving, Jesus did this. You feed them. Then they can actually absorb what you have to say. They've gotten to a level of equilibrium where something can actually come in. We're not distracted. We're not, you know, running around in this imbalance. And so Jesus at the altar, he talks about this. He says, if you go to the altar and you bring your sacrifice, okay, that's formal prayer, right, for the Jewish sacrificial system back in first century. But if you bring your sacrifice to the altar and then you remember that something's wrong in a relationship that you have, leave the gift at the altar and go fix the relationship. He's talking about creating a balance in our lives. That's not just one relationship. It's relationship capital R. You know, it's the way we relate to everyone and everything. If that is out of whack, you know, if we're starving in terms of relationships, it's going to be impossible for us to really pray, to develop this attitude of prayer. And so what we need to do is go back and get that equilibrium, get that balance, get that emotional regulation, because that's the launch pad. That's the platform from which we can actually move into prayer. So if you think about it, steps 4 through 10 that we just went through, right? 4, 5, 6, and 7, dealing with self-exploration, dealing with figuring out who we are and how we operate, and working down deep to bring up the things that have been causing so much dysfunction in our lives and causing our addictions, of course, and work through them, get to a place of equilibrium. And then step 8 and 9 was dealing with our external relationships, bringing those into a place, if not a place of reconciliation, at least a place where we have done all we can do to help the victim that we created find their way to forgiveness, freeing themselves of their victimization, and simultaneously freeing ourselves of that victimization. And so those steps, 4 through 10, were preparing our soil, even if we didn't realize it. The self-exploration we did and the fixing of relationships as well as we could manage helps us prepare the soil for this attitude of prayer. In other words, what we've been doing through these steps, 4 through 10, is feeding our starving selves with awareness. It's the awareness that we were not getting in our diet, to pull that metaphor a little further. Finding that balance, finding that regulation, without which there is no conscious contact with God. Conscious contact is not possible until we've gotten to this place of equilibrium. Because why? Because the contact has to be conscious. If we're out of balance, we're not really there. We're not really conscious of the moment. We're not present. Conscious contact means presence. Presence is the first casualty of emotional dysregulation. It's the first casualty of limiting core beliefs that cause us to act out in all sorts of ways. And so we have been feeding ourselves through these steps, and we need to do that for ourselves if we really want to move into prayer as it's really understood. T.S. Eliot has a great line from his poem, Little Gidding, and I'm sure it's a quote that you've all heard. We shall not cease from exploration. And the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. Gotta love that, right? So what he's talking about is exploration, and he's talking about it in the macro sense, but we're talking about it in the micro sense. I'm sure his poet heart had room for both of those contexts. But exploration, like life, like time itself, and the steps are really circles. See, we think of the steps linearly. We think of them as lines. We think of time as line segments. But what Eliot is saying is that when we end all our exploring, we end up back where we started again. But we know something that we didn't know before. Time is circular. It's not linear. What are our timekeepers, right? Well, it's the moon and the stars and the planets and the sun. They're all moving in circles. It's circles that define our time and define our sense of time. Our old analog clocks used to be circles, and they defined a sense of time. But everything is circular. Every journey we take is circular from an interior point of view. We end up back where we started again. All the important movement in life is circular. It's circles within circles and cycles within cycles, of course. And it's never ending. These cycles never stop. If you think there's a point where you're going to just stop learning, well, then what you've done is you're looking for the living among the dead, as the angels told the women when they came to Jesus. Because if we're in stasis, we're dead. There's never going to be an end to the cycle. I believe that even after the threshold of death, we're still going to be making cycles with God. If he's infinite, then we're always free falling into the center, and we'll never exhaust his possibilities. We'll always be able to be surprised, which makes heaven heaven to me, you know? Otherwise, why would you even want to go there? Each step we take in the 12 steps, and the 12 steps themselves are a circle. They take us on a journey, and they bring us home again. Each one of the steps and the 12 steps as a whole, they bring us back to where we started. But knowing the place for the first time, knowing it in a different way, knowing ourselves more deeply as we go. And then, of course, the question becomes, knowing what? Well, the step here says it's God's will that we're going to know. That's what we're praying to try to find out. God's will is very confusing to us in the West. It was very confusing to me especially, because when we think of God's will, we're thinking about a what. We're thinking about a perfect plan. We're thinking about all the little details and things we need to do so that we're right in the center of God's perfect plan for our life. But when you translate that back into Aramaic and you get God's will as semyana, which really means God's deepest pleasure, delight, deepest purpose. We're really talking about God's essence. What does God take deepest pleasure in? What does God just do naturally that is just the acting out of his nature? This is will, not the way we think of will as something that has to be done, but will is something that flows out effortlessly because it comes from the deepest part of who we are. God's deepest purpose and essence in self is not a what, it's a how, right? And more importantly, it's a who. When we talk about God's will, we're talking about God himself, herself, however you understand God. But this is the person of God that we are getting to know, not something separate from God. We're going to the very deepest part. Now, how are we going to know this? How are we going to know God in this way? Well, take a look at Genesis 4:1. Now, Adam knew Eve. Okay, there's an idiomatic phrase right there. Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. And so to know in Hebrew connotes the deepest intimacy. Now, see, we in the West, when we know something, we're, you know, downloading factoids, data points into our brains. That's what we understand about knowing. We understand it as gaining knowledge, right? Something objective, something that we can actually do. We're gaining knowledge here. But what the Hebrews mean by knowing is complete intimacy, complete familiarity. Their word for know, yada, is actually the word for hand. It means to know how to handle something. It's like a journeyman craftsman with their tools. They know the tools, a musician with the instrument, right? That just muscle memory, that knowing, that is what they mean by know. And so it's very different. And so in Matthew 7 at verse 22, when Jesus says, you know, people are going to say, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then I, God, will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. And of course, we're saying, what the heck? I just gave you 20 years of my life building 24/7 cable networks for God, you know, and churches and all the things that we do. Yeah, but see, here's the thing. You know, what is God saying to these people who have done all this work? We were never intimate. We never got to that place where we connected. God is not throwing them out. God doesn't do that. That's another idiomatic way of speaking. The people have already cast themselves out or just kept themselves apart from because they thought that knowing was part of performance. It was accomplishment. They thought knowing was a what. But God is saying, no, it's a how. It's how we interact. It's how vulnerable and transparent we get. It's being able to be that intimate, that close, where nothing is left off the table. I had a couple of friends once that commented to me. One line was, what have I got to do to be approved by God? Common question, right? But note the context. The person is asking a what question. What have I got to do? And they're looking at do as performance. So they're still in the mode that there's some performance that I need to do in order to get what I need. It's transactional. It's contractual. It's performance-based. Another friend said, I need God to give me one indication that he's there. How many times have we said that in our own lives, right? And that's, it's perfectly unnatural and understandable. But again, the context of the question is looking for a what? It's looking for certainty. There is no certainty in this life. God doesn't give us the certainty, because then that would make faith unnecessary, right? And so these questions indicate that these two people had not yet taken their circle journeys. They had not yet completed the circuit and experienced God's will, experienced God's essence, the oneness that is the center of God's being. At John 8, Jesus says something interesting here. He says, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. All right, we heard this a million times, right? But if you abide in my word, if you break that down, what does it really mean? Well, it could mean to just simply live in my perception of life. Word does not mean a written word. It doesn't even just mean a spoken word. It can mean those things, but it means much more, both in the Greek and logos, right? And in the Aramaic, melta. Both of those words can mean a whole worldview. It could be a whole perception or a scope of understanding. It can mean the basic reason at the center of all creation. It can mean something really, really deep. And so if you abide in my word, if you continue, if you live with the kind of perception that I have over time, you are going to take this circle journey. It will take you around and bring you home again. And it's the only way. Because he said, I'm the way and the truth. No one comes to the Father but through this circular path that takes you down and then up again. It's the only way to know the truth. And not a what truth, not more data points, but the how of God, the who of God. If you think about it, truth is a person when it comes down to it, spiritually, existentially. It's not data that we are understanding. We are getting to know an actual person at the center of everything. And so, how do we take this knowing circle journey? Well, the step 11 says prayer and meditation. Okay. Now, both prayer and meditation really are prayer, but they have different qualities to them, and we need to take a look. When I look at this process of moving from where we sit to that attitude of prayer that has become the essence of our own lives, I see three circles within circles, three circular journeys that we need to take, each one taking us to a deeper level. And this first circle, this first level, is basically the development of awareness. We have to develop our awareness. If we don't have that, we're like the starving child who is not going to be able to focus on studies all day long. So we need to develop awareness, and this requires discipline. Oh, the D word. Yeah, don't like that word. Discipline, the discipline of prayer. These will be the prayers that are set up, you know, formal prayers, prayers that have a formula to them. You know, set prayers like we had. I grew up Catholic, so we had all sorts of prayers. The Our Father, the Hail Mary, the Glory Be, so on and so forth. We had the Rosary. We had different forms. We had the liturgy itself, which was set forms of prayer that were very... So this would be the discipline. Prayers, word-based, and whether it was petitionary or intercessory or whatever the prayer was, these are the formal types of prayer. But we need that structure. In Hebrew, the word is keva. Keva is the structure. Keva is the framework of prayer. It's the words. It's the order of the liturgy. All of that we were just talking about, that is keva. And without that structure, we can't develop awareness. We need to have some structure to this. I want to read you just a little bit about Jewish prayer and see if this brings it home for you. Most people today do not see the need for regular formal prayer. I pray when I feel inspired to, when it's meaningful to me, all right? This attitude overlooks two important things: the purpose of prayer and the need for practice. One purpose of prayer is to increase your awareness of God in your life and the role that God plays in your life. If you only pray when you feel inspired, that is when you're already aware of God, right? Then you will not increase your awareness of God. That's a good point. If you wait till you're inspired, you're already there. We're trying to get ourselves from all that distracted craziness that we have all day and then move us into awareness of God. In addition, if you want to do something well, you have to practice continually, even when you don't feel like doing it. This is true of prayer, as true of prayer as it is of playing a sport, playing a musical instrument, or writing. In the sense of humility and awe of God that is essential to proper prayer does not come easily to modern man and will not simply come to you when you feel the need to pray. If you wait until inspiration strikes, you will not have the skills you need to pray effectively. Before I started praying regularly, I found that when I wanted to pray, I didn't know how. I didn't know what to say or how to say it, how to establish the proper frame of mind. If you pray regularly, you will learn how to express yourself in prayer. And of course, in you know, real Orthodox Jewish settings, there's a lot of this going on. Take a listen. For an observant Jew, prayer is not simply something that happens in synagogue once a week or even three times a day. Prayer is an integral part of everyday life. This is still the keva. This is still the set forms, right? Observant Jews are constantly reminded of God's presence and of our relationship with God because we're continually praying to him. Our first thought in the morning, even before we get out of bed, is a prayer, a set prayer, thanking God for returning our souls to us. Isn't that interesting? You know, you go to sleep, and then in the day, your soul returns, your consciousness returns. I love that. There are prayers to be recited before enjoying any material pleasure, such as eating or wearing new clothes. Prayers to recite before performing any mitzvah, a commandment, a good deed, such as washing hands or lighting candles. Prayers to recite upon seeing anything unusual, such as a king, a rainbow, or the sight of a great tragedy. Prayers to recite whenever some good or bad thing happens, and prayers to recite before going to bed at night. All of these prayers are in addition to formal prayer services, which are performed three times a day, every weekday, and additional times on Shabbat and festivals. See the intricate structure that they have for their keva, the intricate structure for prayer. It keeps them in the mode of constantly practicing their prayer. Do you have any personal structure for your prayer? Do you have set times that you pray? Do you have anything that brings you back on a regular basis to practice this conscious contact, to practice awareness of God? This is what we're talking about, because these set verbal and formal prayers, they provide the practice we need and the framework we need to build and develop the awareness of God's presence. It's like a diving platform that we go to and then allows us to go deeper, or like a base camp on a mountain that allows us to go higher. This is so important to set up the formal structure of our prayer life so that we can practice and become more and more aware in our daily lives of God's presence. And then that can take us to the second circle or the second level, which I'm calling the process of knowing. But now we're moving into meditation. We're moving into centering prayer. So from the word-based prayers of keva, the word-based prayers of all the formal prayers that we say, those set forms can only take us so far. They're useful because they're building a structure and a discipline in our lives. They're building our awareness, but they're word-based, so they're still inside our heads. And so they can only take us so far. It's just like an airplane can't get into orbit. If you want to get into orbit, you got to get in a different vehicle, right? You got to get into a rocket that can attain an escape velocity. So it's the same thing here. We need to get out of the keva car, and we need to get in the kavana car. Kavana, love that word. That's the Hebrew word for prayer that means the intent of prayer, the mindful presence of prayer. This is where everything else goes away and we are truly present to the prayer. This can be in the midst of the formal prayer. They're not exclusive. You can do the rosary and thinking about the laundry list, or you can do the rosary and you can be completely in kavana, completely mindful, completely present. That's what the rosary is for, is to allow your mind to completely let go as you simply follow the beads and continue to say prayers that are built into your DNA by that time, right? And so Kavana is the intent. It's the mindful presence. It moves us beyond words. It moves us beyond thoughts, thoughts that are word-based. And it takes us into a place called sometimes choiceless awareness. We're still aware. Our mind is not quiet. It's not empty. But we choose not to focus on anything that floats through, whether it's a self-generated thought or if it's some sensory input. We just let it go by. But the keva, the structure, the discipline, prepares the soil for the kavana, to the silence, because God's native language is silence. And if we really want to speak to God with no loss in translation, we got to be silent. We got to learn to speak silence. We need to learn to love silence, to rest in silence, and not just be waiting for it to be over so we can turn on the radio again, right? This is the pure presence we're talking about. Henry Nouwen, in his book, The Way of the Heart, says it really well. See if this helps. When Abba Arsenius, one of the ancient desert fathers of the 3rd and 4th century, had asked for the second time, "Lord, lead me to the way of salvation," the voice that spoke to him not only said, "Be silent," but also "Pray always." To pray always. This is the real purpose of the desert life. Solitude and silence can never be separated from the call to unceasing prayer. The desert fathers and mothers did not think of solitude as being alone, but being alone with God. They did not think of silence as not speaking, but as listening to God. Solitude and silence are the context within which prayer is practiced. The literal translation of the words "pray always" is "come to rest." The Greek word for rest is hesychia, and hesychasm is the term which refers to the spirituality of the desert. A hesychast is a man or woman who seeks solitude and silence as the ways to unceasing prayer. The prayer of the hesychast is a prayer of rest. This rest, however, has little to do with the absence of conflict or pain. So important to understand. We can still be in a whirlwind and we can be at rest internally. It is a rest in God in the midst of a very intense daily struggle. Abba Anthony even says to a fellow monk that it belongs to the great work of a man to expect temptations to his last breath. Hesychia, the rest which flows from unceasing prayer, needs to be sought at all costs, even when the flesh is itchy, the world alluring, and the demons noisy. So centering prayer, which is another form of hesychastic prayer, silent prayer. Meditation, which can be used in exactly the same way, is a resting in God, a resting in the presence, not choosing to focus on anything our minds want to grab onto, but just being. We're practicing this pure presence. And the important thing is it doesn't need to be understood. You don't need to understand intellectually what's going on. You just need to experience it. And so the keva, this formal verbal prayer, develops the awareness of presence and allows us to be able to move to the next level, which is silence, because silence begins the process of actually knowing, begins the process of intimacy with God. And we understand at this point that the map is not the territory. The mind can look at a map. Keva, the formal prayers, can get us to see the map of what it is we're doing, but the map is not the territory. The word is not God's voice. God's voice is silence. But the 11th step has two parts to it. The knowledge of God's will, but also the power to carry that out. And immediately we're thinking of another what, right? God is going to tell me what I got to do, and then I got to have the power to carry it out. But this is another call, another circle that we need to take. And this one is going to erase all the lines between prayer and meditation and the daily details of life. Silence, the presence of meditation and centering prayer, is preparing the soil for the practice of presence. And this is going to be the third level that we're moving into, the practice of presence. Take a look at 1 Thessalonians 5, starting at verse 16. Paul is trying to get this across to us. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Jesus Christ. So now God's will is maintaining an attitude of gratitude, right? According to Paul. God's will is praying unceasing, rejoicing always. Now, what does he mean about this unceasing part? You know, if we're going to be doing it constantly, if it's never going to end, well, then we're not talking about saying words. You know, you can't be saying words all the time when you're going through your day. People are going to start putting you into padded rooms if you do that. And you're not going to be able to be in a place of silence where you're not choosing to think about anything, because we have to think about things when we're doing our daily work, right? We have to have a task that's in front of us. We don't want to be thinking about something else, but we still got to be thinking about the task we're doing, right? So during our busy day, unceasing prayer is not about saying words or even maintaining silence. It is that inclination we talked about. It's an attitude toward. It is a oneness with. It is the leaning in of Selah that we're talking about. It's an attitude toward everything we do, not layering in something else on top of what we do. It's the way, it's the how that we do what we do. And of course, if we're going to talk about this third level, we got to talk about Brother Lawrence, right? And some of you know about Brother Lawrence, and we've studied him together. But Brother Lawrence was a 16th century Carmelite monk, French monk. And when he entered the monastery, he thought that he was going to be doing monk things, and they stuck him in the kitchen because he was uneducated and there was nothing else for him to do. And he really resented that for almost 10 years. It wasn't a fast process. But over that decade, that first decade in the monastery, he learned to love the kitchen because he realized that God's presence was just as intense in the kitchen as it was in the chapel or anywhere else. And in fact, for him, it was more so, because that's where he really was doing some good. He was feeding his fellow brothers, you know. And he says, you know, even in the midst of it all, the grease and the noise and the smoke, he said, God's presence was right there. And he developed The Practice of the Presence of God, little book, if you want to read it, where he talks about this process. Just listen to a couple of quotes that he says, and see how this relates to this third circle, this third level of prayer that is erasing the lines between formal, spoken, and even meditational prayer, and just merging it with our day. He says, the time of business does not with me differ from the time of prayer. And in the noise and clatter of my kitchen, while several persons are at the same time calling for different things, I possess God in as great tranquility as if I were upon my knees at the Blessed Sacrament. Lord of all pots and pans and things, how about that appellation for God, right? Make me a saint by getting meals and washing up the plates. We need only to recognize God intimately present with us, to address ourselves to him every moment, that our sanctification did not depend on changing our works, but in doing that for God's sake, which we commonly do for our own. It's transforming the work we do, not adding to it. That it was a great delusion to think that the times of prayer ought to differ from other times, that we are as strictly obliged to adhere to God by action in the time of action as by prayer in the season of prayer. That prayer was nothing else but a sense of the presence of God. And that when the appointed times of prayer were past, he found no difference because he still continued with God, praising and blessing him with all his might, so that he passed his life in continual joy. And finally, I have quitted all forms of devotion and set prayers, but those to which my state obliges me. So what is he saying? No more keva for him, you know? Yeah, he had to go to chapel at the appointed times, but he wasn't adding more of the set discipline and structure. Why? He says, I make it my business only to persevere in his holy presence, wherein I keep myself by a simple attention and a general fond regard to God, which I may call an actual presence of God. Or, to speak better, an habitual, silent, and secret conversation of the soul with God. Listen to the way he sets up the word conversation. It's habitual, it's silent, and secret. This is not a spoken conversation. This is just connection, pure connection. which often causes me joys and raptures inwardly, and sometimes also outwardly, so great that I am forced to use means to moderate them and prevent their appearance to others. In other words, he was getting happy feet, you know, and he had to calm it down, right? In other words, he was no longer saying the prayer. The prayer was saying him. That's the point that he had gotten to. He had transformed himself from the inside out, that his whole DNA was now prayer. His whole DNA was this connection, this inclination, this attitude, this leaning in. When we get to that point that we're constantly aware of God's presence, we're praying unceasingly. This is what Paul is talking about. The silence is internal. It happens in the noisiest environment. You know, the prayer is now saying us. When we can carry our silence with us, then we know something about God, because now God's presence is in everything that we do, and we're starting to see the connection. True prayer, true meditation, is awareness of God's presence in this moment and every moment, not at set times that we carve out. Our attitude toward that presence is our knowing of God. Our changed attitude, our gratitude, even when there is nothing spectacular going on, is proof that we have changed internally, that now we are living in this place that Jesus called kingdom. This ability to relax, to stabilize our emotions, to tighten and value relationships. Until we know God, until we know truth, we can't know or experience God in all these things, or figure out that God is all these things. There is no separation from everything that we experience and God. Love, forgiveness, salvation, it's all God. All God. So there's no substitute for this process. We can't figure it out. We can't get it downloaded, you know, through some book or some program. There is no substitute for the process of praying in circles. The circles, within circles of the experience that we're gaining, is the deepening of the knowing. It is the building of the intimacy. It is the increasing the value of vulnerability and transparency and undefendedness. All these things that we maintain in our fear suddenly can start to be relaxed, because we're getting a sense of the incredible degreeless love that is at the heart of everything here, where there's nothing to fear. We can completely undefend, and we're going to be okay. But we only know that experientially. We'll never be able to just get to the mental certainty that we so want. It's kind of like taking a road trip with God. You ever taken a long road trip with someone? There's nothing like getting to know someone if you're within an enclosed space with them for about 8 hours, day after day, right? Then you really know that person. This is what we're doing. The structure that we set up, that discipline that we apply to the structure we set up, creates the awareness, and it makes mindful presence even possible, which then makes the carrying out of that presence into life possible. And so the power to carry out the will of God doesn't become a performance or a what. It becomes a carrying around of God's essence in our own to everything that we do. In other words, we know we have intimacy with God by living and loving the presence and oneness of God. You know, for years, I banged my head at the wall of prayer. It just didn't make any sense to me. I so wanted to understand prayer. I wanted to understand how it worked, and I kept coming up short. But my problem was, I was trying to understand it with my mind. I was trying to study it. I was trying to dissect it. I wanted to put a pin through it and stick it up on the wall under glass. I wanted to have it control over prayer. No wonder, right? But when I started to actually move into contemplative practice, when I started traveling those circles that we're talking about, I started to experience what my mind could never grasp and would not be able to grasp. It was an intimacy, and it was a familiarity with God that I was only looking at from a distance before. And that experience gave me a sense of authority, my own authority that I never had before, right? My own authority to become convinced of something. And then to try to express it, even if others thought it was heretical, and they did. But I could express it now. And I had a boldness about it because I was so convinced by what I had experienced. When Jesus teaches, he teaches with authority. He astounds the people because he wasn't teaching like the scribes and the Pharisees who are reading out of the playbook, right? The Kiva. He taught with a deep conviction. I'm not comparing myself to Jesus, but I know the difference between the two. To have gone through the experience gives you a sense of something deeper that you know you can stand on. You know that you know, even if you can't prove it to anybody else, you just know. And that makes all the difference. But my expression to you, I'm just telling you what I'm convinced of, right? My expression to you and Jesus' expression to you, preserved in the New Testament, in the Gospels, are just words. They're just more data points. They will never get you to certainty. Right? They'll never even get you to conviction. But if you choose to use them as your map, as your roadmap, and if you will follow Jesus' path as laid out here, circles within circles, then you begin to know the territory from the map. You actually know the terrain. You know what it feels like, and that makes all the difference in the world. And when we do that, what are we going to find? I want to just read a little bit from the 12 and 12 and see what they say. Perhaps one of the greatest rewards of meditation and prayer is the sense of belonging that comes to us. We no longer live in a completely hostile world. We are no longer lost and frightened and purposeless. The moment we catch even a glimpse of God's will, the moment we begin to see truth, justice, and love as the real and eternal things in life, we are no longer deeply disturbed by all the seeming evidence to the contrary that surrounds us in purely human affairs. We know that God lovingly watches over us. We know that when we turn to God, all will be well with us, here and hereafter. It's all about belonging. It's belonging. At the end of each circle of exploring, at the end of each circle of prayer, at the end of each circle of experiencing, or better, maybe at the beginning of the next one, because it's just circle on top of circle, right? We're going to find more and more that we belong, that everything belongs, even the things that we deeply despise, they belong too. The more we travel these circles, we'll see how they fit in to the fabric of things. But we belong to God and to each and every other that we meet along the way. Belonging is God's will. Belonging is God's essence. Belonging is the truth, the who and the how. At the end of each circle or prayer, everything belongs. And you may be thinking that we skip two words, and they're important words, and they're simply for us. Praying for the knowledge of God's will for us, knowing God's will for us, that means it's personal. That means it's intimate. That means it's for us, right? Each and every person at the same time has God's will for themselves. But there's only one God. That means there's only one will, one deepest purpose, one essence for that God. And that will does not change because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, right? And so the belonging of absolute unity and oneness that is God's will for each and every one of us. See, we're obsessed with looking for the details of the what. And so that would mean that everybody's will for them would be different. But God looks at the unity of how, and that is the same for each and every one of us. And it can't be transferred. It can't be bestowed. It has to be experienced in circles of prayer and circles of self-exploration. There's no other way. Knowledge of God's will for us would mean nothing without the power to carry it out. But it's only in the carrying out that we can know God and God's will in the first place. The two work absolutely hand in glove. And so we begin. Keva, Kavana, and practicing the presence of God. If we will abide in those circles within circles, we can develop the attitude of prayer that is the essence of kingdom. Let's pray. In many ways, Father, this is where the rubber hits the road. But how much has had to happen before we could even talk about the difference between what we imagine our journey to be and what it really is? We pray that our soil has been prepared, is being prepared, that we are getting closer and closer, if we're not already engaged, to being able to see our prayer life as our life, our only life, that there is no difference between the two, but still willing to do what we need to do to continue to prepare our soil so that we can live that life that you have for us, that is the greatest expression of our Sibyana, our purpose and will as human beings. So, Father, we give you permission to take us there. Help us step by step to take the next step, to travel circle after circle and start to recognize more and more when we come back to where we started that we really do know you better, ourselves and our place in life. So thank you, Father, for everything that you've given us to make this happen in our lives. Help us to do our part so that we can partner with you and know you for the first time. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, would you all stand?